Praise God. Good morning, everybody. Praise God. Was that a new offertory song? It's bigger. That was the title, Bigger. What was the title of that? Oh, really? That was good. We enjoyed that. Well, good morning. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the house of our God. Amen. I don't know how you're feeling, so I'm not going to ask you how you're feeling. I'm just going to say it's good to see you here. You know, I'm glad you're here. And, you know, once you take the effort to get here, I'm sure you're glad you're here also. So praise God. You know, I believe God has something to say to us today. I really do. You know, I've been enjoying the messages that we've been getting from Pastor Phil. I've been enjoying those Ezekiels. I enjoyed them so much, I just tagged along with you, you know. But I believe in that. I believe that, my goodness, I believe that God is speaking to us in a different way. Some time ago, I believe that God said that that he wanted to bring us into the mystery of Christ, to begin to know the mystery of Christ. And I believe the mystery of Christ is the same as the mystery of being. When you find out who Christ is, you find out who you are. I love the understanding of the mysteries. The mysteries is this. There's something about God and life and you that you'll figure out. And there's something about you and life and God that you'll never figure out. That's how a mystery works. You'll get to understand some of it, but not all of it. You'll never figure out who you are. You'll never figure out who God is. Never completely. But little by little, we do. So I want to talk about one of those mysteries today. As a matter of fact, I want to talk about the mystery of the crown of thorns. If you look into your bulletins, the title today is Thinking Differently, but I think the subtitle is The Mystery of the Crown of Thorns. You know, I did a little research on the crown of thorns, and some say that the crown of thorns that Jesus Christ wore is still in existence today. Now, I'm sure it's not actually true, but I know there are those who actually hold the relics in possession, and they like to believe that it's the actual item. You ever hear or watch the movie The Robe, where they thought that they actually had the robe of Christ still after his resurrection? But as I studied the crown of thorns, it is said that the crown of thorns is still in existence today and that it resides in the Louvre Museum in Paris, France. And Brother Keith has a picture of that for us today. I want us to look at that picture of what they say is the actual crown of thorns that Christ wore on the cross. Now, whether it is or it isn't is not important, but let's look at the image for a while. Even as I saw this image, I noticed that it didn't look like a green or thorny crown. It actually looked a little glorified in that picture. Like, what did they do? Dip it in gold? It looks interesting. But I think the picture is going to suit our conversation today, because I do believe that the crown of thorns has a certain glory attached to it that we don't yet understand. And I think the mystery will unravel that for us. If you have your Bibles and you want to turn to a verse, let's turn to John, the 19th chapter, and let's talk about the mystery of the crown of thorns for a second. I like talking about the mysteries of God and the house of God, because you're not going to discover them anywhere else. I don't care if 60 Minutes does an expose on the mysteries of Christ. They'll never fully understand the things of God, because they have the wrong sauce. They have history and they have humanity, but they don't have the heart of God. And we go right to the source, and he will unfold the mysteries. We can have our own 60 Minutes. Tune in. So the 19th chapter of John, the first verse, it says, "Then Pilate took Jesus and had flogged him. The soldiers," it says, "that they twisted," or they crafted together, "a crown of thorns," such as the one we saw, "and put it on his head. They clothed him in a purple robe and went up to him again and again, saying," mocking him, "Hail, King of the Jews." And they slapped him in his face. And then once more Pilate came out and said to the Jews that were gathered there, "Look, I am bringing him out to you to let you know that I find no basis for a charge against him." Remember the conflict that Pilate had within himself? And so he said, I don't find anything wrong with this man. He even washed his hands, if you remembered. And when Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe, they weren't doing that to coronate him or deify him. They were doing that to mock him. But yet he still wore the crown and he wore the robe. Yes. And then Pilate said, behold, or here is the man, behold the man who you call King of Jews. And when they crucified Jesus, they even had that placard above the cross and it said, King of the Jews. And they even protested that. They said, don't write King of the Jews, right? He said that he was the King of the Jews. Don't proclaim that as such. And what did Pilate say? What I have written, I have written. Let it be King of the Jews. And they gave him the crown of thorns, the image that you saw, to mock him. As a matter of fact, they say that crown of thorns, it may have been the thorns of a palm tree. Have you ever cut down a palm tree and found the big thorns on a palm tree? They say it may have been the same kind of a palm tree when Jesus came into the city Jerusalem riding upon a donkey, and they took the palm branches and they threw them down and they said, Hail, King of the Jews. Amen. And a week later, they take the thorns from the palms and fashion a crown and stick it upon his head and say, We have no king but Caesar. The confusion of man. The confusion. Ha! Love and hate. Such confusion. But Jesus was never confused. He always knew what he was doing. Praise God, huh? Yeah. We are utterly confused, but God is never confused. And he will still work out his glory and his purpose in our lives, whether you know it or not, whether I can figure it out or not. Amen, everybody. Amen. So he wore that crown, but he knew why he was wearing that crown. He knew it was an act of God that he wore that crown. It was not the act of man. I know it might have been some centurions or some folks that wanted to mock him and craft that and stick it upon his head and said, here's your crown. But that was prophesied and ordained that he would wear that crown. Uh-huh. And today I want to talk about the mystery of the crown of thorns. Amen. It's a crown that you and I wear as well, the crown of thorns. So let's look at the thorn for a minute. If you're going to look at the thorn, you got to go to the first place that appears in Scripture. Where is that? Genesis, the very beginning, Genesis chapter 3. And you know the story of Adam and Eve, right? It says after the fall, it says, God said to Adam, he said, because you listened to your wife and you ate the fruit of the tree about which I commanded you, you must not eat from it. Cursed is the ground because of you. Through painful toil, you will eat from it all the days of your life. It will produce what? Thorns. The ground will produce thorns and thistles for you, and you will eat the plants of the field. It goes on to say, as you all well know, by the sweat of your brow, you will eat your food until you return to the ground. Sometimes it feels that way, don't it? From the sweat of your brow, you will eat your food until you return to the ground. How's that as defining your life? Sometimes it feels like our life. Since you were taken from it, for dust you are, and to dust you return. Amen. The word of the Lord. Let's talk about the thorns for a minute. It seems as if the story of Genesis, the beginning of all things, teaches us that thorns are a part of life. From the very beginning of time, thorns are a part of life. Can I get a witness? At one moment, you find yourself frolicking in the Garden of Eden, talking with God in the cool of the day, right? As Adam and Eve, living in bliss. And in the next moment, you'll be working hard by the sweat of your brow, being pricked by the thorns of life. Amen. You see, thorns are a part of life. Thorns are a part of life. I believe, once again, it's the toast of the Count of Monte Cristo. One day you'll be basking in the sun, and the next day you'll be shattered upon the rocks. See, the paradise and glory is a part of life, but so are the thorns, everybody. Thorns are a part of life. As a matter of fact, just yesterday I found myself in the garden and I was trimming my azalea bush. Does anybody know what an azalea bush is? You know for sure if you got one in your yard. Azalea bushes, they're beautiful. They got the pink flowers. I think they're very beautiful. But they grow so fast. But what you notice is when you trim your azalea bush, man, that thing will poke you 1,000 times, man. I've never got more scratched up than when I trim an azalea bush. I got blood all the way up my arm. And then I trimmed the palm trees. You got palm trees in your yard? Man, those thorns are this big, such as they fashioned the crown with. So just yesterday I found myself in the garden and I was trimming my azalea bush and I was trimming my palm tree and I was being poked by the thorns. Now I'll tell you the truth. I didn't pull the azalea bush out and I didn't cut the palm tree down. No, I didn't. What did I do? I did what we were commanded to do. I tended the garden. And we will tend our garden. And you will, and I guess the greatest example is the rose, right? Right? Every rose has its thorn. Now, God forbid you take the roses out of your garden. I know some of you that are still brave enough to plant the roses in your garden. Some of you dare to say, I love the roses. I love the rose bush. But every rose has its thorn. You see, God created life with thorns. In life, you will have the paradise of God, but you will also have the thorns that will prick you. Such is the mystery, I guess, everybody. Now, we don't pull the rose bushes out of your garden. You don't chop down the palm trees. As a matter of fact, you plant them. But what do, everybody? You tend the garden. And I think such is discovering the mystery of the thorns, the mystery of the crown of thorns. I think more and more God's not looking to get things out of your life. I believe in your immaturity and my immaturity as a young Christian or just as the immature state of the church. We think that the purpose of God and Christianity is to get the thorns out of your life. And we're discovering that's not the purpose of God. We think if everyone who's sick, he's going to heal you. No, that's not the truth, everybody. That's not the truth. Sickness is a part of life, and I would dare to say so is death. Yes, it is. It's the cycle. Part of life is death and sickness. Sometimes you're weak and sometimes you're strong, but somehow, and like in the back of our Christian minds and theology, we think that it's God's plan to take away your sickness, to take away your suffering, to take away your death, and to take away your thorns, and it is not. And sometimes we sing about a heaven by and by where there'll be no more tears and there'll be no more sorrow and there'll be no more death. Yes, I understand that. But in this life, God is not looking to take things out. It's part of life. So therefore, what he wants to do is change our minds. He wants to give us understanding so we're not tormented by our experiences. And I think when you grow up in God, you begin to understand, my goodness, God is not looking to make you rich. You might be rich, you might be poor. I don't know what God has planned for you. But it's not the plan of God for everybody to be rich and everybody to be strong and everybody to be healthy. It is not the plan of God. Because the thorns are a part of life. And maybe just if God would just bring you to that revelation, you wouldn't be tormented so much when sickness comes. And you wouldn't be tormented so much when death comes. And maybe you'd be able to handle poverty just a little bit better. And maybe you'd be able to handle sickness just a little bit better. If we would understand that all is for the glory of God. Amen, amen, everybody. And he has reasons and he has purposes. And maybe for us to surrender to God's purposes and maybe look for him in it. If God wants you down, you'll be down. If God wants you up, you'll be up. And it has nothing to do with your foolishness or your weakness. It's just God. Amen. Amen. He's causing us to understand this and that we are more than conquerors in all of these things, everybody. He's now looking to take the thorns out. The thorns are a part of life. Jesus Christ came to the earth in part to be pricked by the same thorns in the flesh. He came so that he would also be pricked by the thorns. He didn't come to take the thorns away. He came to be pricked by the thorns. That's why he wore the crown. Amen. He said, I'm not taking your thorns away. I'm going to show you how to live this life, and I will be pricked by the same thorns that you're pricked by, but I will show you that there's glory in it. There's glory in it. And I know it don't feel like it at times, and most of the times when you're being pricked, you don't feel the glory. But he came to this life not to take your thorns away. He came to wear your thorns and to be pricked by the same thorns. Yes. And on the cross, they put that crown upon him. They didn't know what they were doing, but Jesus did. Yes. You know, in the Mount of Transfiguration, when Jesus went up to the mountain, he was transfigured, and it was there that he finally just told his disciples, listen, the only reason why I'm born upon this earth is to die. And when he went on the Mount of Transfiguration, there was two biblical figures that appeared with him. You know who was in the mountain with him? I forget who they were. Moses. Who's the other guy? Moses and Elijah. Shut up. So there were two that appeared with him on the mountain. So in this passage here, it says, it came to pass 8 days after these sayings that he took Peter, James, and John, and he went up to the mountain to pray. And as he prayed, the appearance of his face altered, and his robe became white and glistening. And behold, two men talked with him, and they were, as you said, Moses and Elijah, who appeared in glory and spoke of his decease, his exodus that was about to be accomplished at Jerusalem. So here we are, Jesus is having a mountaintop experience. Can you imagine that experience? Some of you just want to be Peter and John. If I could just see it happen, man. He had a mountaintop. Man, it said that he shined like light, man, like lightning. There was glory all over him. And life has these experiences. In life, you'll have some of these experiences. You'll have these mountaintop experiences. But in his mountaintop in good times, God told him, and he said, listen, I'm just getting ready for my departure. There is also a bottom of this mountain too. And it said at that time, he set his face towards Jerusalem because he knew that he was going to go towards Jerusalem because they were going to betray him. They were going to try him and kill him and crucify him. And at that point, he set his face towards Jerusalem, knowing that now my purpose is to go and die upon a cross. And he knew it after his glorious mountaintop experience. I have my mountaintop experience, but that's not all of life, because life also has its thorns. Life also has its thorns. And you'll have glory and you'll have thorns. And the thorns will always be part of your life, always. And so will the glory. Amen. One good amen at the right time. Perfectly timed. Perfectly timed. And you can say amen. Just look at your life this week. I don't know. Maybe you had a great week. Most of us, you know, it's up, it's down. And the promise is, I won't take the thorns away, but I'll give you understanding. I'll show you the mystery of the thorn. Okay. You might as well accept that, because that's all you're getting. So you see, from that point, he went towards Jerusalem, and on his way to Jerusalem, he had many stops. There was one time, it said here, later in Luke 9, in verse 51, it says, now it came to pass, when it had come for him to be received up, that he steadfastly set his face to go to Jerusalem, and sent messengers before his face. And as they went, they entered a village of the Samaritans to prepare for him. But they did not receive him. And they did not receive him because they weren't supposed to receive him. Like God put it in their hearts to reject him. They did not receive him because his face was set for the journey to Jerusalem. Amen. And when his disciples, James and John, saw this, they said, Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them just like Elijah did? You know that story, right? His face was set towards Jerusalem. He knew from the mountain he was going to the cross. And on the way, he came to the Samaritan village. The same Samaritans where he saved the one Samaritan woman and the whole town was saved. You think when he entered again, they'd have a little party for him. But he came this time and there was no party for him. They wouldn't even let him pass through. And the disciples were so indignant, and they said, hey, let's call down the fire of God, man. Jesus said, no, man. They're only doing what they're supposed to do. Jesus said, I'm supposed to get pricked by the same thorns. And as he walked towards Jerusalem, I want to show us the thorn after thorn after thorn. I want to see that crown of thorns being made, but by not by the hands of man, but by the hands of God. And Jesus would be pricked by the same thorns in life that you and I are pricked by. To let you know and to let me know, I'm not taking the thorns out of your life. I'm just going to be pricked by the same thorns. I'm just going to show you the mystery of the thorn. Okay, let's see the mystery of the thorn. You might as well look at the mystery because you're not getting rid of the thorn. I know you all want to get rid of the thorns, okay? That message ain't coming. The only message that's coming is God's going to show you the mystery of the thorn.
Yes.
So in this passage here, one of the thorns is rejection, absolute rejection. You will be rejected in this life. It will never end. In this life, you will suffer rejection.
Yes.
You'll suffer rejection from those. Man, it doesn't hurt unless they're close to you.
Uh-huh.
It don't hurt. It don't work. The thorn don't work unless you love them and want them. You'll be rejected by the folks that you shouldn't be rejected by. It's like, God, I was so good to them. They turned. All I did was save them and help them and they reject you. You're gonna receive rejection. And it don't work unless it's close, man. If it don't hurt, it don't work. It's gotta hurt. And it pricked him and that was one of the thorns that was fashioned in this crown of thorns. And as he goes on, you know some of the encounters that Jesus had on his way to the cross. How about Judas Iscariot? How about the betrayal itself? How about the betrayal itself? It says it wasn't a stranger that betrayed him. It was one who he sat in fellowship with. It was one who was a friend. It was one who he had dinner with, who came over the house at night and he hung out with. It was somebody that he loved dearly that betrayed him for what? For what? For filthy lucre. Can you imagine someone you love, a friend, betraying you for a few dollars? Like, I'll give you a few dollars, but I'm not going to pay you to be my friend. He suffered betrayal by the hands of man? No. Scripture prophesied. By the hands of God.
Yes.
He was to suffer that thorn of betrayal. And I tell you, in this life, you will be betrayed. It's part of life. Thorns are part of life. You'll be loved. I tell you, you'll be loved, everybody. Oh, praise the Lord. And sometimes you'll be hated by the same people.
Uh-huh.
And you'll be betrayed by the same ones who love you. So what did Jesus do? Well, he was hurt for sure, because it don't work if it don't hurt. But he still loved Judas. And you know the end of the story of Judas. His heart was broken, right? His heart was broken. He said, I betrayed innocent blood. He couldn't even live with himself. I betrayed innocent blood. But the thorns are just part of life. You don't even know why you do, and people don't know why they do what they do. But if we understand that God is working in it, it's okay. God is working in it, everybody. You know, you have the thorns of rejection. You have the thorns of betrayal. And one that I really wanted to, not only Judas, you know, they all betrayed him, by the way. I know we all get on Judas. Everyone betrayed him that night. Remember when they arrested Jesus? Not one of them stood with him. They all ran. Even the toughest guy, Peter. He denied him so much he would curse. A little girl tripped him up. You remember that one? They say of Mark, that Mark's the guy that he was running so fast, they grabbed his garment, and he left his garment, and he ran out of that garden naked. That'd be something my brother Phil would do. He would run so hard. Betrayal. Another thing that he was pricked by in life, and see, Jesus came not to take the thorns out of your life. Now, you know that to be true because so far you still have thorns in your life, right?
Yeah.
I've been pricked a couple of times this week, an azalea bush and a palm tree. Did I tell you the story? So I was pricked a couple of times this week. But you see, Jesus didn't come to take the thorns out of your life. He just came to be pricked by the same thorns you're pricked by. And the next one I want to talk about, and I think it's really personal to our church and to us right now, it's the thorn of loss. And especially, you know, the loss of loved ones. You see, in life you will experience loss. There's no way you're not going to get that out. You'll experience all kinds of loss. It's one of the thorns of life. And Jesus didn't come to take that out of your life. He just came to bring you understanding, because in life you'll still experience loss. I don't know how old you are, but so far you still experience loss, don't you? But I say one of the toughest ones and that we really struggle with, it's the loss of loved ones. And that's a tough one too. And we think with Christ, you know, our loved ones aren't going to die anymore. And, you know, I say, man, in my immaturity, just maybe in our love and our pain, man, we don't want our loved ones to die. We'll have all-night prayer meetings. We'll call everybody we know. Let's pray for so-and-so. They're not going to die. I tell you, this one ain't dying. I don't know. Sometimes we live and sometimes we die. But the loss of a loved one is one of those thorns that will always be part of life. When I think of Jesus Christ, I think of one of the losses that he suffered was his cousin, John the Baptist. His cousin died, age of 30. And look at his death. He really died for Christ. He died for his cousin. Remember the story? They cut his head off. Jesus didn't prevent it. But he realized something. He came to wear the crown of thorns. He knew the mystery of the thorn. He knew there was something about that death. I believe as he was going towards Jerusalem, he got a report. I think he even wrote down the report. Remember Lazarus? It says, now a certain man was sick, Lazarus of Bethany, the town of Mary and his sister Martha. And it was that Mary that anointed the Lord with fragrant oil and wiped his feet with her hair. Do you remember? Whose brother Lazarus was sick. And therefore the sisters sent him saying, Lord, oh my goodness, he wasn't dead yet. He was just sick. Sent to him saying, Lord, Lord, he whom you love is sick. You think Jesus would have marched right over there and healed him? Well, I tell you something, it's a little comforting knowing that he didn't, because there's a lot of loved ones I got that he didn't heal. So I'm somewhat comforted by scripture, because I've had a lot of loved ones that I would cry out to say, Lord, they're sick. Would you heal them? But he didn't heal him.
Yes.
And we prayed. And we're church folk and we're God people. And therefore we should receive the blessing of healing. We didn't get it.
Amen.
Neither did Lazarus. Said he's sick. Would you heal him? Did he heal him? No. The story goes on. When Jesus heard that, he said, this sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified. Okay, you read that, you think he's not going to die. What happened to Lazarus? He died. I can't tell you how many folks we've had march through this church where we believed that God was going to heal him. And we would say and we would pray over the years of our existence, 35 years. And we would say, this one is not unto death. God, I could name some names, but I'm not going to name them. And we'd say, this one is not unto death. God's going to heal him. Because we heard the word of God that he was going to be glorified in it. But then they died. Man, if that don't rock your world. If that don't rock your world. And Jesus said it was for glory. But they died. So Lazarus died. But what was the death for? I know we think it's just the thorn to crush us and bruise us and to hurt us. But Jesus says the death was for glory. It's going to produce glory. And you know, the glory is resurrection, whether it's in that moment resurrection is always in the moment. But the glory is resurrection. God does allow these thorns to prick you in your life. You will experience the loss of loved ones. And I'm sorry, as long as you live, you will experience the loss of loved ones. And then you yourself will experience that death. It's a thorn, but it's for the purpose of glory. But we don't see the glory right away. Sometimes we just feel the pain. But God says that will produce a certain glory in our lives. It's only through the pain and the suffering that it produces. I tell you what it produces. Some of the things I think you learn to cherish life a little more. And you learn to cherish the people around you a little bit more. And you get to discover the mystery of life when you experience the loss of a loved one. You get to experience the mystery of life because you understand that life can be just for a moment. And any one of us can leave this earth at any time.
Yes.
And it starts to redefine who you are and why you are. And we're not on this earth to do anything more. Sometimes just to take care of our loved ones and to love our loved ones.
Amen.
There's something greater in this life. And and the people all around us, man, sometimes we discard our relationships and we discard our friendships because we're busy with life until you lose a couple of folks. And then it's like, man, I got no one to live for anymore. He said, this loss of life, it's for the glory of God. And it truly is. It truly is. That glory will be seen through it all. And Jesus did not come to take this thorn out of your life, but he came to experience it with you. And that helps. That helps when I know that Jesus experienced the thorn that I experienced. And he wept the same tears that I wept. Amen, everybody. And then, coming down to a close, I guess, I want to talk about this thorn again. Do you remember when Paul had his vision? Paul had a vision. He had a vision that he was in paradise, the Genesis story. He went to paradise. He had a taste of heaven, if you will. I think it's 1 Corinthians 12. Where it says, it is doubtless not profitable for me to boast, but I'm going to boast a little bit. I will come to visions and revelations of the Lord. He said, I know of a man in Christ who 14 years ago, whether in the body, I do not know, or whether out of the body, I do not know, but God knows, such as one was caught up to the third heaven. And I know such a man, whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know, God knows. It says how he was caught up to the paradise and heard inexpressible words which are not lawful for a man to utter. And Paul said, I have experienced the things of God. I have experienced God himself. He experienced the glory of God and even the glory of life that is given to us by God. I have experienced and I have tasted and I have touched such glory. And I would say, such as some of us in this house, you have experienced and tasted the glories of God. Revelations, understandings that are too beautiful. But in the same stroke, in the same story, if you will, such as the Genesis story, along with this paradise, if you will, there were thorns. And here in Paul's story, along with his paradise came thorns. Not only did he experience the goodness and the glory of God and of life itself. I don't know what you consider to be beautiful in this life. I don't know whether it's a certain relationship. I don't know if it's a certain success. I don't know if it's a certain something. But whatever you find to be glorious in life, God will give you the glories. He'll give you wives and husbands and children and grandchildren. He'll give you comforts that you want in this life. He'll give you the glories of it. Yes, he will. He'll give you the glories of it. He'll give you the desires of your heart. He'll give you the rose, if you will. He will give you that paradise. But with that paradise and with that rose, you must understand that life comes with thorns. Amen. And he'll give you the glories and the joys of all that there is in life. But he says, do not be alarmed when that thorn pricks you. And when that thorn hurts you, it doesn't take away from the glory that you had. It doesn't take away from the love that you experienced. From the happiness, it does not take away from it. But that rose does have a thorn, and there will be a prick, and there will be a pain, and there will be a sorrow. And therefore, along with all the glories of life, sometimes you'll get pricked. And Jesus says, do not be alarmed. He didn't say, I'll take it away. He says, I'll be pricked with you. Because such is the mystery of the thorn. It's the mystery of the thorn. This is something that can be so beautiful, but sometimes it's the most fragile of things that are the most beautiful of things. And sometimes the most precious of moments are the ones that are so fleeting. Yes. That are so fleeting. And you only had the moment, but now you're just left with the memories. Yes. But enjoy the memories. Amen. And thank God for it. And God said, I didn't come to take the thorn, but I came to show you the mystery of the thorn. Yes. So after Paul had this vision, you know what happened to Paul? It says, and I want to read it because I don't want to mess it up. He says, unless I should be exalted, Paul said, oh, such is life, man. He says, unless I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of revelation, God also gave him a thorn in the flesh. Like along with this beautiful, glorious, grand life, unless you be exalted above measure, I got to put a little thorn in there. And you say, why, God? We know why, but we pretend like we don't know why. Because we'll be haughty and proud and callous and not caring about anything or anyone but our own glory. We kind of know that it humbles us and and grounds us and keeps us compassionate and close to the brokenhearted. Amen.
Amen.
Why was Jesus pricked with thorns?
Yes.
Why did they put that crown of thorns on his head? So that he could comfort you in your thorns. Because he would know your pain and he would know your sorrow. So that he could comfort you and help you through it. Why do you have a thorn? Well, part of it is God wants you to comfort others around you. You ever hear someone telling you of their sorrow? Sometimes you're absolutely indifferent. Anyone ever tell you of a sorrow they had and you were absolutely indifferent? You really didn't care? I mean, God's honest truth, yes. Sometimes you just don't care. You think they're just, oh, here, this pain in the neck again, going to tell me all their problems. Not that, right? You done that, Sandra? But when we're pricked by the thorns in life, it causes us to bleed with them and cry with them. And sometimes I don't need somebody giving me all the answers. Sometimes you just need someone to cry with you and tell you, man, that's a terrible thing. That's a tragic thing. And somehow I believe in this thing that we bear one another's burdens. I believe spiritually and physically there's a God thing about you. There's something God about you. That when you sit somebody with their sorrow, you are actually spiritually able to bear that burden. Have you ever experienced that before?
Yes.
Physically?
Yes.
Have you ever felt like, wow, like all of a sudden the person you were sitting with, all of a sudden you felt like that sorrow was transferred to you and you felt that?
Yes.
And that's the mystery of the crown. And the only reason that person can get through that tragic thing is if you can go next to them and take a little bit of that pain from them.
Yes.
Because it's too much. It's too much. And therefore, God will send that person, and then you'll share that burden, and then together you get through it. But it doesn't take the thorn away. Because life comes with thorns. And God says, I'm not going to deceive you. I didn't come to take the thorns out of your life. I didn't come to make you rich. I didn't come to make you strong. I didn't come to make you healthy. I didn't come to make sure you never die.
Uh-huh.
No. It's part of life, but it's not all of life.
Yes.
He said, I came to bear your sorrow, to be with you in it. You know he's with you in the good times, because every time you're good, you say, thank you, Jesus.
Yes.
But he says, I'm going to sit with you in your thorn. I'm going to take the crown upon my head also. And such is the mystery of life, everybody. It's the mystery of life. You will always have thorns in this life. Always. And there's purpose in it. And there's glory in it, everybody. So I want to talk to you about the glory. That crown of thorns, when I saw that picture, it's like, man, it looks like it's been dipped in gold. But the mystery of the crown of thorns, everybody. You see, God is not going to take your thorns out of your life. He's just going to change the way you think. He's going to show you the mystery of the crown, the crown of thorns, everybody. You see, this thing about the crown of thorns. You know, we all see that at the end of it all. It said that God crowned Jesus with glory. But I tell you what, I think the crown is the same. I think the crown of thorns is the crown of glory. It's the same crown, because you can't have one without the other. I believe there's a passage and it goes something like this. It says, for our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all, everybody. So we fix our eyes upon Jesus, but on what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. Our light momentary afflictions are not worthy to be compared to the glory. If you could experience the rose and the thorn, and if you had the choice never to experience that rose, so you would not be pricked by that thorn, I guarantee you would always pick the rose. And you'd always take the prick for getting it. Amen, everybody.
Amen.
I know you've lost loved ones, but would you rather have not have them or had them? No. No. And you'll have the memory of them, and you'll have them in your heart. And there is something called resurrection, everybody. Amen. And there is glory. There's glory for them, and there's glory for you. It's just that for a moment in time, I'm going to tell you something now, just for a short moment in time, you get a little prick. It's okay. Because there is glory. Amen, everybody. For the pain and produces the glory. It says, I have a passage here. It says here in Romans, talking about sufferings, it says, but we also rejoice in our sufferings because we know that suffering produces, it produces perseverance, and perseverance produces character, and character produces hope. You know, I tell you all the time, when I was teaching Sunday school, and I had one of my little students come up to me, and they made a magnet. I remember the magnet to this day. It was a white magnet, and it had gold glitter on it. And in the gold glitter, the saying was, do not pray for an easy life. Pray that God would make you a strong person. Amen. And you can stay a baby forever. Not really, but you might think you want to stay a baby forever. And you might think that you want to be rich and healthy and never experience sickness and never experience death. But that's the state of a baby, and God would never leave you that in that place. But he will grow you up. Amen?
Amen.
And he will make you strong. And it is the sufferings in life that will make you strong. And then after you have endured the sufferings of life and you have had the crown of thorns pierce your skin, and you will have something to offer this world. You will have an empathy, you will have a compassion, you will have a strength that is larger than life. That can actually touch someone and help someone. Well, you would have the ability to sit down with somebody in their sorrow and their defeat and bear their burden with them. And you will go into other people's lives. And I want you to know this mystery. I want you to know this mystery. You will not take the thorns out of their lives. You will not. But you will bear their thorns with them. For Christ is our example. And you will allow yourself to be pierced by the same thorn. That is the mystery of the thorn. It is not to take the thorns out, but it is to experience the same thorn.
Yes.
It's the mystery, everybody.
Uh-huh.
God wants you to know the mystery. God wants you to know that mystery. And as you continue in your life, you will have the glories of heaven. And you will have your mountaintop experience, and you will experience love and bliss and prosperity, joy and laughter. Yes, you will. But you will also experience the thorn. And you'll never get it out of your life. It's part of life. But God wants to show us the glory. Because that crown of thorns, it is the crown of glory.
Uh-huh.
It's the same crown. And if we think differently, we will discover that. And every sorrow that you experience in this life, it is for glory. And every loss of a loved one you experience in this life, I want you to declare by your hearts and by your spirits, this is not unto death. The loved ones that you have lost, it is not unto death. It is not unto death. It is for the glory of God. And I will say that of my loved ones, because I love them enough to realize that their death was not for nothing, and that there's a higher purpose than it all. Because we think that man crafted that crown of thorns and stuck it upon his head. But it was not. It was love.
Uh-huh.
It was God.
Yes.
It's the mystery, everybody. Amen, everybody. Amen. May God open that up to us. I'm going to ask our praise and worship team to come forward. I pray that we leave without understanding. God will not take the thorn from your life, but he will experience the thorn with you. Amen. God bless you. Why don't you all stand?
One another's burdens. And in doing so, you will fulfill the law of Christ. What is the law of Christ? Just help others, man. Especially in their time of burden, especially in their time of trouble. That's when the law of Christ really kicks in and we help one another. Amen? Let's go before the Lord. Heavenly Father, we are grateful for the word this morning, Lord God. And Lord, help us to see, Lord. Help us to hear, Lord. Help us to say we will be of good cheer when those thorns come, Lord God. But open our eyes to the others, Lord God, so that we can bear each other's burdens, Lord. Strengthen us together, Lord God, so that we know that we can do it together, Lord God. Holding on to one another, Lord God. And in doing so, Lord, we fulfill the law of Christ, Lord God, which is grace. Help us to live by grace, Lord God. So we thank you for this message, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you continue to strengthen us, Lord God. And pray, Lord God, that we would live with that understanding, Lord God, and that you'd continue to open our eyes to see it differently and think differently, Lord. So we thank you, Lord God, for the day, Lord God, for the family, and for all you're doing. It's in your name we pray. Amen.